it was during the pregnancy of my last son in 2003 that I had this incident occurred. So around midday, I saw the signs that the baby was due. Between the second and the third stage of the delivery, we just had 5 minutes. Normally it should take at least 15 to 20 minutes, you know, but by God's grace, the baby came out. And around the same time, my brother, who is a surgeon at 37, was a surgeon at 37 military hospital at the time. My mother and my husband had arrived. They're very excited. They said, hey, is the baby born? They said, yes. You know, like, can we see the baby? They say, yes. You know, they're working on him. But all is not well. Your wife has a bit of a problem, you know. So my brother, because he was a medical personnel, liaised with the gynecologist. And they decided that I had to go into theater immediately. They thought that my uterus might have ruptured, you know, before sending me. So they wanted to quickly get it out. What had happened to me is what they call amniotic fluid embolism. The amniotic fluid is what surrounds the baby. It has somehow entered my bloodstream. And once the amniotic fluid touches the blood, it acts as an anticoagulant. So my blood stopped coagulating and I was pouring. Fortunately, my brother was able to get 2 pints of blood in 37 hospital. The whole of 37 had only 2 pints of my blood group, the ORH positive. And I'm told that when the nurses were giving the blood, they said, oh, only 2, you know, because it was not, it would have been woefully inadequate. My husband's cousin was a doctor at the general hospital at the time, so he also called him and he also arranged for some blood. My husband went and brought the other 2 pints. So they administered the 4 pints to me, and by God's grace and a lot of prayers, there was a lot of grace that day. I came back to life. I mean, in this country today, 8 women die every day from childbirth, and out of those 8, 2 die from hemorrhage, blood-related incidents. You know, so if we had blood, I'm sure that we can really, really save some of our mothers.
The National Blood Service Ghana is an agency of the Ministry of Health mandated to ensure the safety adequacy of blood and blood components, making it accessible and affordable to patients in all hospitals in the country. So it does this through its operational areas, through education of blood donors, through mobilizing them, collecting the blood, testing, screening, also preparing blood components, and storing, distributing to hospitals as and when they need the blood.
Roughly, if I start from the countrywide, we know that WHO estimates that usually 1% of the population is the country's blood needs. So that works up to about 250,000 units in every year.
The National Blood Service is supposed to supply about 200 units of blood, you know, every day out to. Even Kolebu alone will supply about close to 150 units of blood to Kolebu. Not to talk about other hospitals that, you know, we supply.
Our voluntary donations are about 45% countrywide, and I think that our aim is to have 100% voluntary donors.
With all the scientific developments that we have, man has not been able to replicate blood. You can only get blood from a fellow human being. Therefore, it takes a lot of sacrifice and human love to donate blood.
Well, I think that the biggest challenge that we face is Ghanaians embracing blood donation as a way of life. I think that the concept hasn't sunk very well into the public domain.
Blood donation is safe. It's safe because there are professionals who are trained in the process. So they take you to a good history. If a good history is done, a clinical proper screening is done, I mean, there's no risk.
After the process, you can go back to work. You can do whatever you want to do, except that if you're operating maybe a machine which will take too much energy out of you, we don't advise that after donation, you go and operate those machines.
Any person who has donated blood must be between the ages of 17 and 60 years. It should be of a sound mind, male or female. And anybody who is well, I mean, you must be quite well yourself. That's why I said in good health, to be able to donate blood.
Many people argue that blood is donated freely. So why is it that when a patient needs the blood, they have to pay something for it? And I keep saying that, look, the blood that people donate must be seen as the raw material.
Blood must be collected in the blood bank. You must test your blood. You must screen in the blood. You must, store the reagents that are bought. And that comes at a cost.
And for now, it is 35 cedis. Other facilities are charging much, much, much higher than that. But we need to bear in mind that sometimes when a person needs blood, he needs 2 units, 3 units, 4 units. And so when you charge too much for blood, then it becomes a problem because many people can't afford it.
I woke up that morning, I was fit like you. I had no idea that I would end up with 4 pints of blood. My case was a bit extreme. Most people just need a pint to survive.
I know the spirit of volunteerism needs to be rekindled in this country. It used to be quite a lot, but I think that we need to go back to that. People should give themselves voluntarily to help those who are in need.
The National Blood Service has a blood drive at the Accra Mall the last Saturday of every month. And I think this would be a very good way to support them.
A person can donate blood voluntarily every 4 months. And I think that if more and more and more people do this, we'll find out that suddenly we don't have any problem of acute blood shortages in Ghana.
This is a national assignment. So anytime, anywhere they hear of blood donation, please respond.
Because the way it works, there's no way I will ever know who saved my life. But I can assure you that you have a special place in my heart. Because of people like you, my children are not motherless. I'm able to attend their PTA meetings. I'm able to have little parties for them when it's their birthday. And they've grown up feeling the love of a mother.